or Dr. T, whatever is the easiest for y'all to call me. But I did go to school here in Winfield, and then I went to Auburn and got my undergraduate degree and also went to vet school there. Different kinds of veterinarians out there. There's some that do just small animals, like you think dogs, cats, you know, rabbits, those kind of things. And there's ones that do big animals. And I typically do bigger animals. I deal with cows and horses and goats and sheep and pigs, but I can also help dogs and cats. And this is what I would typically wear to work every day. These are coveralls if you get really, really dirty. I will say that much. You know, if you don't want to get dirty, that may not be the best thing for you, but you can always wash it. But I always wear my coveralls, and I got a scrub top, and then my stethoscope I always have on me. It's more than just a necklace. I know that, you know, it just looks cool, but we use this every time we go look at an animal. You know, we can listen to their heart, we can listen to their lungs, we can even listen to like their guts and everything and hear if everything's moving really good, because that matters a lot in some animals. Right here it says small animal vets work in an office, and most of them really do, but their patients visit them there. But for big animals like a cow, you can't bring a cow into an office, right? So you got to go to the farm to see them, and that's what I do. I have a big truck, and I have a box in that truck that has all of my medicines and my equipment and everything else, and I go to the farm, and I go see that cow or that horse or goat, and I take care of them there because they can't bring them to me. But basically, you know, I was going to talk to y'all a little bit about some basic things that you'd want to do with your veterinarian in terms of your dog and cat. So how many times a year do you think you should take your dog or your cat to the vet? Y'all know? Yeah, once a year. That's the best time. Take them once a year. And if they're sick, you know, you take them more often. But once a year, you're going to bring them up there and they're going to give them shots for certain diseases that you don't want them to. I know y'all don't like shots, do you?
No.
But they help a lot. You like shots? There's certain diseases that they get. So if you go to your veterinarian, and let's say you have a dog, like you got a new puppy, right? So you go up there and you get them something that's called a parvo shot. That's a really bad disease that dogs get that you don't want them to get. It's good to have those shots. And not animals don't always have the same diseases we do.
I don't like
you don't? Okay. They're not fun most of the time. But a lot of times, I mean, the animals can't tell us they don't like them, but sometimes, you know, you can tell they don't. They may even give them something to help with worms because animals do get worms. And some of those worms people can get. So you want to make sure that you deworm your animals, your dogs and your cats, because that wouldn't be good, would it? And a lot of those medicines you're going to give them to once a month for fleas and ticks and any kind of worms they're going to get. You can give them sometimes a pill in their mouth or you can put it on their neck. But how many of y'all have tried to give a cat medicine in its mouth? Have any of y'all tried that? Did you come out okay? Did you get scratched? Yeah, I figured. What would y'all do if you had some sort of stray dog or a stray cat come up to your house? Would you go out there and pet it and start playing with it? And they may even look friendly and they may be scared, you know, they may hurt you on accident, but it's very important not to just go up and, you know, pet or play with some animal you don't. Yeah, you don't want to get bit or scratched. It's best not to touch, you know, an animal that you don't know about. You can go and tell an adult that it's there, you know, especially if it looks like a stray animal that's running around, and let somebody know so they can take care of it. But let's say there's someone walking around the park and they have their dog on a leash. Would you still run up and pet it then?
I would ask.
Exactly. That's the best thing to do. Ask them. Make sure it's okay, and then you can go up and pet them. And see, sometimes stuff that doesn't seem scary to us may be scary to a dog. You know, even if it's a friendly dog, you run up to its face, you know, to go pet it, that's kind of scary to them. I mean, how would you feel if someone ran up to you and started waving in your face, you know, or anything like that? That'd be a little strange, wouldn't it? So even a nice dog could act a little weird. So you just have to be, you know, slow with them, you know. You can let them sniff of you and then start petting them. It's best not to go, you know, super fast. Because like I said, you don't want to get bit. And it'd be bad.
What should they do if they ever do get bit by a strange animal?
If you ever get bit by a strange animal, you need to tell an adult. And you may end up having to go to the doctor to make sure that you're okay and everything. Because some of that stuff has to be reported, actually. Because the sad thing is that y'all know about rabies.
Yes.
Rabies is a bad, bad thing. And it's not every animal has it. And not every animal that's going to hurt you can have it. But it's very important you go talk to somebody because you don't want that. It could be very, very bad for you. So you always let somebody know, and a lot of times they'll let the vet know. And then I would tell someone else that's higher up than me, and they take care of everything. But if it's, you know, if it's a dog that you know has had its shots, for rabies and everything, usually you would just keep it up somewhere for a while and make sure it's fine. But you don't want to go petting or messing with any animal that you're not familiar with. It's just not a good idea. And right now, too, it's getting really hot, right? Really hot. Do you just leave your dog, you know, outside in the sun when it's this hot? That's not a good idea. They need to have something, some sort of shade, you know, a tree, a dog house, something like that. Plenty of fresh water. And that's something that'd be easy for y'all to do, you know, if you have a dog or cat. Go out there and make sure they have fresh water. Give it to them, you know, once or twice a day, and that way it's cool. Because you wouldn't want to go drink out of a dirty bowl, would you? It'd be kind of nasty. If it's just got old water in it, not cold, and you're out there sweating, and you're just like, I wouldn't want to drink that. Mange, it's actually something that's caused by a mite. It's a bug. It kind of looks like a spider almost. It's got like 6 legs, and you look at it under a microscope is how I have to look at it. But you know those mangy looking animals, you know? Right. They would have no fur, really crusty looking, really, you know, nasty. Right. It'd be really bad. And there's 2 different kinds of mange. Actually, there's one people could get. So it's probably best you don't touch. If you see an animal that's losing hair and stuff like that, I probably wouldn't touch it. Or if you do, have gloves on, you know, and make sure you don't touch it. That's another thing, too. A lot of people don't know this, but you can't actually keep any kind of wildlife in Alabama as a pet. You can't keep it in your house. You can't do anything like that. So raccoons, squirrels, even like little songbirds, if one fell out of a tree, you can't do anything with it. You'd get in big trouble if you did. You just have to let it go. Because, I mean, it's wildlife. You have to let nature take care of it and everything. But you're not allowed to keep, you know, raccoons, possums, armadillos, anything like that as a pet. So just keep that in mind, you know, if anyone's asking you about it, you know, to be like, nope, can't do that. A bird. You can have like a parrot, you know, or a parakeet or something like that. But any of these birds that are wild, the ones that are outside, like, you know, like a little songbird, a mockingbird, blue jay, that kind of thing, you can't keep those as pets. You have to let them, you know, stay outside. A turtle, you can't mess. The turtles that are outside, you can't have those either. Yeah, you can get one from a pet store or something like that. That's fine. But there's certain stuff that's, all has to do with the government and everything, but you get in really big trouble. You can't keep any of those because they just have to be in the wild. But anything that you would get from like a pet store or something would be fine. Any kind of turtle from there would be okay. Albino animals, they're ones they actually have in their like genes and their material that makes up what they are. They have a mutation, which is what we call where they just have something abnormal in there, and if something didn't work quite right, so they don't have any pigment in their skin. So, you know, like you go outside and you get tan in the sun and everything, they can't do that. They are just white because they don't have any pigment anywhere. Yeah, there's some albino rhinos. You can get albino any animal. Have y'all ever seen albino alligator? There's some of those at zoos. Those are the same thing. They have something wrong in their genes and it just makes them like that. And you know those, the black jaguars and panthers and stuff? They have the same thing, but it's a different, you know, but it's black. They're called melanocytic animals. It's the opposite of albino, but basically they're black and jet black.
What's the rarest?
The rarest, let's see. Well, I'll tell you what, I deal with a lot of, let's say, expensive cows and stuff, and that's probably the strangest thing. There's some of those cows, believe it or not, that are worth about $50,000, depending. And that's probably, you know, to me, that's rare. You're not going to find that everywhere. And other than that, I do a lot of, like I said, I do cows and horses and things like that. But it was the strangest thing I ever saw was actually a guinea pig at school because I didn't see a lot of small things. I mean, I saw dogs and cats, but we call guinea pigs things like that. Pocket pets is what we like to call them because they're almost like you can keep them in your pocket. They're little bitty. So I didn't see a lot of those. So it was kind of weird. I haven't seen, you know, gotten to actually work on a lot of really strange things. But you definitely get a little antsy when you're in there working on an animal that's worth, you know, $50,000 or something. You don't want to mess up. If you like puzzles, being a vet is a good thing because you can sit there. You have to figure things out. They can't tell you where it hurts. They can't tell you what's wrong.
They can't come in and tell you where they hurt like
exactly.
We can.
You don't know. So you're just like, well, I think it's this, but it's like, little Fluffy here isn't going to tell me, you know, that her stomach hurts. You have to be able to figure that out. So it's really cool. I've always enjoyed it. And It's important. You got to be a good reader because you got to read a lot. You read a lot of stuff, especially when you get into vet school, if that's what you want to do. But a lot of big words. You learn a lot of new words because some of them are in other languages, but you get to learn a lot of really, really neat stuff.
What about hybrid animals?
So a hybrid animal is something where you mix one and another and get something. There's the first thing I can think of is something called a beefalo, and that's something where you can cross a bison, you know, those that are out there, with a cow, and you get a beefalo. You can get, there's like different stuff like that, you know, like a lion and a tiger, and you get a liger. That's what a hybrid would be.
One animal I won't touch.
I will say I'm not a huge fan of birds. It's just weird. I don't know. Their beaks, they could bite your finger off with their beak, and that's just a little weird. I don't mind snakes. Depending on the kind of snake it is, you know, some of them are, if they're a pet, a lot of times they're handled a good bit, and they can be pretty nice. Now, I'm not going to go messing with a wild snake. That's a good way to get bit, but someone's pet, I don't mind them very much. And some snakes are. There are, you know, venomous snakes around here, and there's a lot of them, so you have to be really careful. I wouldn't touch or go near any snake that's outside. But if you know how to tell a difference, or your parents do or something, it's not a bad idea to leave the ones that aren't venomous, because they eat certain pests like rats and mice and things. If you're scared, you can put those mothballs, you know, around your house or under it or something to keep them away. But personally, I would leave, you know, if it's a chicken snake or something, as long as it's not in your house, you know, or hurting anything. You know, even just go stick it in the woods and it would be fine. But they get rid of, you know, rats and mice and stuff like that you don't want in your house. Copperheads are different. They're not like, you know, water moccasins will just chase after you. But copperheads, just the snake that they are, they like to lie and wait. So they're, you know, they're colored like leaves. So they'll just curl up and sit there in the leaves. And they don't move until, you know, something comes by that they want to eat. And that's just how they, you know, that's how they get their prey. And they don't have to go chase after it to come to them. But I wouldn't mess with them. You know, if you see one, I would leave it alone because it would be really bad. But snakes are pretty cool.